This week on The Inside Story, Alaska, America's strategic frontier. Join us on a journey to the 49th state and see why the United States military has such a significant presence here. Strap into a fighter jet and learn about the American Missile Defense System, plus a look at Alaska's statehood and geography. Join us for The Inside Story, Alaska, America's strategic frontier.
Hello, I'm Carla Babb reporting at Joint Base Elmendorf-Richardson in Alaska, America's last frontier. For many Americans, the mystery surrounding the state stems from its remote location on the northernmost tip of the continent. Alaska borders no other U.S. state attached to the continent through a border with Canada. Much of the state is a frozen tundra seated above the Arctic Circle, with lots of wilderness and few people. It's also big. How big? Texas was the biggest U.S. state before Alaska was admitted, and you can fit all of Texas inside Alaska with plenty of room to spare. And U.S. officials say it's precisely that size and location that provide many strategic advantages for American national security. That's why American troops have operated in Alaska since before it became a state. That's why growing threats from Russia and China have the U.S. military looking not just east, but north. And that's why major changes are sweeping across several of the bases in Alaska. VOA gained exclusive access to take you inside some of the advantages and challenges at each of these bases, starting with the northernmost, Eielson Air Force Base near the Arctic Circle. But the best way to show you Eielson's multi-billion dollar transformation isn't here on the ground. Follow me into the sky.
Here we go.
Soaring in an F-16.
All right, here comes afterburner.
At the top of the world, backseat with the U.S. Air Force. Over America's last frontier, Alaska.
All right.
They got checked.
At times flying faster than the speed of sound.
We are now supersonic.
An F-35, America's newest stealth jet, beside us. A sea of snow-covered peaks below.
15,000.
The tallest in North America, the majestic Denali nearby.
Beautiful, isn't it?
My pilot, Major Lloyd Wright, call sign Bond, has navigated these skies for the last 7 years.
I've flown a lot of places in the world, and this is like the best airspace in the entire planet. It's absolutely a national treasure.
But American fighter jets aren't here for the views.
The military calls this strategic airspace. We've just arrived at the Arctic Circle, and from here, fighter jets can reach anywhere in the Northern Hemisphere in a single flight.
And it's hard to understand that, looking at a normal map that stretches Alaska out over the top of the map. But when you look at a globe, it becomes very apparent how close we are to really anything in the Northern Hemisphere.
Europe is just across the Arctic Ocean. Mainland Alaska is less than 100 kilometers from Russia. And Asia, just across the Pacific.
We're closer to the Indo-Pacific than they are sitting in Hawaii.
With growing fears of Chinese and North Korean attacks. A few years ago, the Defense Department was looking to close most of Eielson.
DOD argued that the cost to operate and maintain Eielson was expensive due to the environment and the climate in Alaska. And ultimately, they proposed a major realignment.
Airspace larger than Florida, right here in Alaska, right behind me. And all of that was on the chopping block.
Alaska Senator Dan Sullivan tells VOA the people of Fairbanks, the city closest to Eielson, pushed back. So did an independent commission set up to evaluate the Pentagon's proposed base changes.
Because they found that it wouldn't actually generate the original savings expected. The commission also argued that Eielson was important as an airbase because it has great air ranges and extensive complexes.
After downsizing Eielson failed to take off, the Air Force did a 180, ordering its training squadron of F-16s to stay put, while deciding in 2016 to add not one, but two new squadrons of F-35s. 6 years and 54 of these F-35s later, Eielson is a combat-ready base equipped to fight at a moment's notice. These combat aircraft are worth about $5 billion
And the Pentagon has spent an additional $600 million building more runways, more hangars, more fuel tanks, more upgrades to accommodate the new jets and new people.
Case in point, it's always busy here. There's only over about 20 minutes where there's not airplanes flying around right here.
But keeping these aircraft and the base operating in the Arctic is a struggle. Temperatures soar to 80 degrees Fahrenheit or 26 degrees Celsius in summer and dip to 50 below zero in winter.
We have challenges just keeping that equipment running because it was never designed to work in temperatures that are so extreme.
Fortunately for the Air Force, there's one thing that works great in cold weather. Giant supercomputers.
So believe it or not, the aircraft themselves, like you said, are supercomputers, right? Computers operate really well in the cold. However, the cold brings a lot of challenges as far as just taxiing aircraft on the flight line as well. Negative 40 below is quite the experience when it comes to tow jobs. Even touching metal outside burns your hands. Like, it's absolutely insane.
So here's one of the colder weather jackets here.
And even with proper clothing, at about negative 20, air crews can only stay outside 10 minutes before having to warm up inside 50 minutes.
So an hour's job takes six people what would normally take one person to do in an hour.
Spring and summer bring their own extremes. During our visit, falling snow turned the base into a swamp. The sound of pumps competing with the jet engines. And operating on top of the world also means operating at the end of the supply line. So airmen must find new ways for resourcing essentials like jet fuel.
We're very unique in the sense that we're pretty much self-sufficient off the state of Alaska. So we actually pull our fuel off the Alaskan pipeline, the crude. It's refined in North Pole and then pumped directly to the base.
Lieutenant Colonel Adam Starkey runs logistics.
You're looking at about just over 100,000 parts for the F-35. This has certainly been the most challenging job I've had in the Air Force. It's been a big learning curve putting F-35s in the Arctic and kind of figuring out what those challenges are.
The last two jets landed here in April. Just in time, Sullivan says, to deter Russia's power plays.
They've been doing bear bomber missions. We've had to scramble more F-22s to go intercept those bombers, probably more than any other time since the mid-1980s. So they're aggressive here too. And the only thing that Putin understands, the only thing in my view that Xi Jinping understands in this new era of authoritarian aggression is power.
The new F-35s at Eielson, combined with the F-22s at a base in Anchorage, give Alaska more than 100 combat-ready fifth-generation fighters. That's more stealth air power than anywhere else on the globe. There's a saying everyone at Eielson knows from the godfather of the Air Force. In 1935, General Billy Mitchell told Congress, "Whoever holds Alaska will hold the world." I think it is the most important strategic place in the world. More than 85 years later, Eielson's expansion amid Arctic extremes illustrate how the state continues to be a linchpin of America's defense.
Frigid and frosty are two ways to describe Alaska's environment in the winter and the challenges it poses for the Pentagon. Let me give you a little more background about Alaska, its people, and its wildlife.
In the White House, President Eisenhower signs the proclamation that makes Alaska's entry into the Union official.
January 3, 1959, Alaska joins the U.S. as the 49th state. Flag makers quickly got to work adding an extra star in a 7x7 pattern. Alaska is the largest of the 50 states, boasting nearly 1.5 million square kilometers of territory, despite having a population about the same as Washington, D.C., which covers only a fraction at about 176 square kilometers. Its capital city, Juneau, is roughly 6,000 kilometers from the nation's capital. Alaska is also home to a handful of military bases and is of strategic importance given its proximity to Northeast Asia. An 88-kilometer stretch of water separates Alaska from Russia, which sold the territory to the United States in 1868 for just $7.2 million. The 49th state is home to more than 1,000 vertebrate species, some of which have been at the center of political battles over oil drilling in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. Alaska is known as America's last frontier for its remote location and vastly unsettled land. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
With Russia's invasion of Ukraine, U.S. allies fear Russia or other aggressors like China or North Korea could attack them as well. It's a threat the American military is constantly training for, especially in Alaska. Let's return to Eielson Air Force Base for a firsthand look at how the U.S. military prepares.
Good morning, Meg.
Back in the air with the U.S. Air Force. We are flying at NATO's western flank with Russia, in what is also the closest U.S. state to Beijing. Both now brandishing their power. Russia invading Ukraine, China threatening war over Taiwan.
It's not just great power competition, it's authoritarian, dictatorship aggression. And Alaska can play a huge role in making sure we're ready for it.
To prepare, war games. Eielson Air Force Base hosts multiple Red Flag Alaska exercises each year, training thousands of U.S. forces, along with allies from across the globe.
So to this flag, we have Canada and we have the United Kingdom. This year, we're incorporating Singapore, and we'll bring in New Zealand and Australia.
Once here, trainees face a fierce team known as the 18th Aggressor Squadron. The team includes my pilot, Major Lloyd Wright, call sign Bond, donning communist red stars from shoulder to helmet.
Usually pretending to be Chinese, Russian, North Korean airplanes.
It's kind of fun being the bad guy.
Make four, break left turn, bandit. 7 o'clock.
Back in the air, the dogfight is on.
We found him.
It's a team of American F-35s against Bond and the rest of the MiGs.
MiG-2, MiG-1, right.
A tongue-in-cheek reference to the Russian-made MiG fighters.
I am doing my best to do the tactics and all the airframe abilities and disabilities of our adversaries.
Uh-huh.
And we're going to try and palm the F-35's defended asset list. You want to pull some Gs?
Yes.
Because here we go.
Alaska is more than double the size of Texas, with a population only about the size of Washington, D.C. So pilots have most of this last frontier airspace all to themselves.
Yeah, so during Red Flag, we'll fly down these, like, river valleys. They'll fly down these river valleys. And so it's really fun to try and, like, find them. It's like the most expensive game of hide-and-seek laser tag you've ever heard of.
Bingo. Bingo.
The weapons in Red Flag are not real.
Staff, flare.
But the responses mimic real combat.
Musket 2, copy kill.
Big 4, copy kill. You're dead.
Oh, they got
us? You just turned into a big ball of flame.
We just died.
Red Flag planner Lieutenant Colonel Greg Hunger says the training gives the U.S. and allies a chance to identify their vulnerabilities.
So the problems they occur, usually we see week one get fixed in week two. So that if they went to combat week three, those things are all resolved.
And with worries, Russia could be inching the globe to the brink of World War III. Base Commander Colonel David Berkland, who spent his more than 20-year career flying both the F-16 and the F-35, says Eielson's strategic importance is growing.
It just makes everything that goes on here at Eielson that much more real, relevant, I think, to the global situation.
A real motivation for these exercises to continue. The U.S. views the Arctic as a growing area of competition with Russia and China, particularly as climate change brings warmer temperatures that open economic and military valuable sea lanes for longer periods of time. But officials have acknowledged that the U.S. lags behind those nations. So the U.S. Army has revamped its forces in Alaska, raising a new 11th Airborne Division to better prepare for future cold weather conflicts. The change will replace Alaska's Heavy Striker Brigade with a light infantry unit better suited for operating in the Arctic. I sat down with Army Chief of Staff General James McConville on the day he stood up the division at Fort Wainwright and here at Joint Base Elmendorf-Richardson to discuss what the new division will bring.
Well, I think soldiers are really excited about becoming the 11th Airborne Division. I think it's given them an identity, it's given them a purpose, And for soldiers, that really matters. The 11th Airborne Division has a really proud history of valor and also innovation. And valor during World War II. And so these soldiers will have an identity of living up to the legacy of those who've gone before them, those who fought in the Philippines during World War II. And we'll have an airborne brigade and an air assault brigade that's very good at warfighting in the Arctic.
This is the first time that an airborne division has been stood up in nearly 70 years. So people are looking at the Army and asking, why now?
Well, I think it's about the mission. We want to have a brigade that has a forced entry airborne capability, and we also want to have a brigade that can do air assault operations in the Arctic, but also maneuver in the Arctic with the appropriate equipment.
Is there going to be any new additional funding? Is there going to be savings from the strikers that can be used to provide new equipment?
They're going to get the brand new, most modern cold weather gear that's imaginable. In fact, we want to test them. We're in the process of getting what we call CATVs, which is cold weather all-terrain vehicles, vehicles that are designed to operate in the snow, in the extreme weather, and they're going to be the first ones to get those type of vehicles. So we're getting them the equipment they need, we're getting the weapon systems they need, and we're bringing that together, and that's going to happen over the next couple of really years to make sure that they have what they need to do the job in this environment.
I want to switch just a little bit and talk about the new Arctic strategy. Very important where we are right here. And as I was reading it, I was struck by the title. The title is Regaining Arctic Dominance.
That's right.
And that implies that the United States does not have Arctic dominance at this point. Is that fair?
Well, I wouldn't say it's quite like that. We just, you know, what we're starting to see as some of the ice melts, there's a lot more competition up in the Arctic. And what we want to make sure is we have the units that are fully prepared to compete. And so having military units that can operate in this environment, that exude strength, that can work with our allies and partners is one of the ways we get to the peace, and that's what we want.
Lawmakers and even military officials have said that Russia and China have a little bit of an advantage. Do you see that as well?
Well, I don't, but you know, I don't want to have a sense of hubris that, you know, we plan for the worst and hope for the best. And so I want to make sure that our units are really highly trained, they're disciplined, they're fit, and they're ready to operate in this environment. And that's what this is all about.
And you said something at the ceremony today. You told the soldiers winning matters. It's the last thing that you said. And so the expectation is not that the soldiers just succeed in the Arctic, but they dominate.
That's right.
How long is that going to take?
It's going to take months to get rid of the strikers and get the new equipment in. But you know, these are tough soldiers, and you know, the mindset that we want them to have is when we send a unit somewhere, we're not sending them to participate. We're not sending them to try hard. We're sending them to win because there's no second place or honorable mention in combat. And if you're strong, you tend to avoid combat because no one wants to fight you. And that's what we want with our forces.
Russia has been very aggressive with its invasion of Ukraine. They have been bullying Finland and Sweden over their application to join NATO. And should we have to come to Finland's or Sweden's aid with this division, this Arctic capable division, be among those leading the charge?
If we require brigade type forces that are highly trained in Arctic warfighting, it only makes sense that these would be the ones. So it just gives our leaders options on the type of forces that they want to employ. And also you have the capability of having an airborne brigade that can do forced entries into extreme weather, into mountainous conditions, into high altitude situations. And so if the senior leadership needs that type of capability, we can offer it.
As somebody who's been up here multiple times, when you look at the cost, the physical cost, the financial cost of keeping bases running up here in the extreme cold and how that compares to the benefits, what do you tell Pentagon leaders? Is it worth it to keep maintaining these bases up here in the Arctic?
Absolutely. I think, first of all, this is a strategic location that we should have joint forces, which we do, and it's also a great place to train. So I think this is absolutely something we need for the future.
One of the biggest military concerns about Russia and China is their nuclear weapons stockpile. The U.S., Russia, and China all keep enough nuclear weapons in their arsenals to end civilization. Should Vladimir Putin or Xi Jinping decide to launch hundreds of nuclear weapons, the U.S. military could not stop all of them. It could only fire back, likely leading to mutual assured destruction of all parties. But the U.S. can defend against a limited nuclear attack from a rogue nation like North Korea, a looming threat as Pyongyang this year tested its first ICBM since 2017 and continues a provocative streak in weapons demonstrations. We take you inside two military bases in Alaska key to that defense.
Implement site reporting. Implement site reporting.
This is clear. Standby for site reporting. Have you received an LMPI?
A presumed intercontinental ballistic missile, an ICBM, just launched from North Korean territory. Space-based radar sound the alarm. Now, this team at Clear Space Force Station in Alaska must quickly verify it with their ground-based radar.
System status? System stable?
Copy and concur. This is clear. Site report is valid. Number of objects is 1.
This North Korea launch is just a drill, declassified for VOA to show how Clear Space Force Station serves as a virtual detection shield.
We like to say that we're the 300 on this base protecting the 300 million.
But Deputy Base Commander Major Dave Kim tells me those launches are part of life here. With North Korea firing 16 ballistic missiles this year, including an ICBM test that Clear confirmed in March.
We're watching them 24/7. We see what they do. I like to describe this job as a no-fail mission. There is zero room for error. Absolutely not.
ICBM payloads separate in space, creating complex debris fields. The Space Force Station's current ground-based radar can track space objects up to 5,000 kilometers away. But the image isn't clear, making it difficult to pick out an incoming warhead. So the U.S. government built a $1.5 billion tool for its tracking arsenal, the new Long-Range Discrimination Radar, or LRDR. VOA got a rare look inside LRDR. The technology in these panels, officials say, make it the most sophisticated radar on the planet.
LRDR is able to look into that adversarial threat cloud and differentiate which object is the warhead that we want to hit. If I could compare it to anything, it would be watching regular TV versus 4K or 8K.
But tracking alone won't stop a missile.
We have to do a hit to kill, and that's something we can do.
Lieutenant Colonel Chris Stutz commands the Missile Defense Battalion at Fort Greely, Alaska, overseeing soldiers who protect 40 of these ICBM-killing missiles, known as ground-based interceptors, in silos deep underground.
We'll see that incoming threat, and if we are authorized to engage it, our weapon system will send a task plan, if you will, to however many missiles that we need to service that incoming threat. These clamshells will explode open and that missile will launch.
To date, interceptors have hit just 10 of 19 targets, a 53% success rate. But Ian Williams of the Center for Strategic and International Studies calls that misleading.
If you actually drill down, right, a lot of the tests' failures were in very early prototype models that are not the models that are currently deployed today. In fact, if you look at the kill vehicle models that are on the interceptors today, there's only been one failure.
The government just constructed 20 new silos here. VOA is the first news outlet to go inside one.
Take a look at this. This is the inside of one of the new missile silos that's going to house the next generation interceptor. Those should be operational around 2028, and they're going to be a more advanced version of the current interceptors here at Fort Greely.
The biggest advancement, each new next generation interceptor, or NGI, housed here will have multiple kill vehicles, the part of the missile used to take out a warhead.
And what that means is by having multiple kill vehicles on one interceptor, you don't have to fire as many interceptors at a single object.
A reassurance as threats from North Korea continue. And these bases, nestled in the Alaskan wilderness, remain America's last line of defense.
That's all the time we have for now in Alaska. Stay up to date on Facebook and Instagram at VOA News. Read more about our trip inside Alaska's military significance on voanews.com and follow me on Twitter at CarlaBabVOA. See you next week on The Inside Story.